We'll begin with a prayer, a brief prayer. Just stay seated.
It's not right.
In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Good and gracious God, we thank you for gathering us together tonight. Thank you for this opportunity to gather and know about Christian funeral liturgy. May this serve as one of our preparations in our journey towards you. This we ask of you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Are we able to meet them? Thank you. Good evening once again. I'm Father Rector Tolentino, and my goal tonight is to share with you about Christian funeral liturgy. First, I thought I should share with you why did I decide to organize this evening and to make a presentation. You know, I had been a priest or pastor at St. Joseph's Parish in Smithers for a good 6 years, I think. And one of my desire is to do this presentation because in one of my readings, which I will show with to you shortly, is that part of my obligation as a priest, as a pastor, is to keep my parishioners informed. So for all those years, I've been feeling incomplete. So tonight, in my mind, is a night of fulfillment that I'm able to accomplish that task. Because in the order of Christian funeral, this book that you are seeing, Jasmine, can you? In paragraph number 9, for instance, this is what we see, or we found. As part of the pastoral ministry, parish priests, pastors, and other ministers should instruct the parish community on the Christian meaning of death and on the purpose and significance of the church's liturgical rites for the dead. And continuing on, information on how the parish community assists families in preparing for funerals should also be provided. So that's the goal for tonight. I thought by doing this, we will be able to keep you informed what is the expectation of the church when we prepare for a funeral. So to some of you, maybe this will just be a review. To some of you, this may be something new. But the hope is that when we live here, we should be able to at least get something. The first part of the night, my task is to walk us through with the liturgy and the expectation of the church. And then we'll have a kind of 5-10 minutes break in between. And after that, I had invited a lawyer in the name of Caroline and Caroline, and she will also give a presentation about what is expected of us as well in terms of the civil government, you know, that the things that we need to prepare. Okay? So, how does Christian view view death? And so again, I go back to this book, The Order of Christian Funerals, and right at the very beginning, we find the following words, and you may allow me to read it. In the face of death, the Church confidently proclaims that God has created each person for eternal life, and that Jesus, the Son of God, by his death and resurrection, has broken the chains of sin and death that bound humanity. Continue. Christ achieved his task of redeeming humanity and giving perfect glory to God, principally by the Paschal mystery of His blessed passion, resurrection from the dead, and glorious ascension. Therefore, if in union with Christ we have imitated His death, we shall also imitate Him in His resurrection. So at the death of a Christian, we proclaim the promise of Jesus to all of us, that if Jesus died and rose again, then the same is going to happen to those who believe in Him. That's the one of the beautiful things that we give emphasis and we proclaim whenever we celebrate the Christian funeral liturgy. That we will rise again. That's the promise. That's how we should view death as Christians. Now, I turn to the Code of Canon Law just to present to you who has the right for Christian funeral liturgy. And this is covered from Canon 1176 to 1185. And if you may allow me to read it. The title is Ecclesiastical Funerals. In 1176, paragraph number 1, we find deceased members of the Christian faithful must be given ecclesiastical funerals according to the norm of law. So we have been baptized, we're Catholic, we belong to the church, it is our right to have the Christian funeral liturgy. Who else? Number 1183 of the canon law would say, and I quote, when it concerns funerals, catechumens must be counted among the Christian faithful. So those who are preparing to be baptized in the Catholic Church, and it happened that that person dies, that person also would have a Christian funeral in the Catholic Church. Who else? Paragraph number 2 of that same code says, the local ordinary can permit children whom the parents intended to baptize but who died before baptism to be given ecclesiastical funerals. So children who were not baptized yet but intended by the parents. And paragraph number 3 of that same code would say, in the prudent judgment of the local ordinary, ecclesiastical funerals can be granted to baptized persons who are enrolled in a non-Catholic church or ecclesial community unless their intention is evidently to the contrary and provided that their own minister is not available. So even those who were not baptized in the Catholic faith, but in other Christian churches, they can be admitted and they can have their funeral liturgy inside our churches if so desired, provided that their own minister is not available. So be mindful of that. I remember when I was in Smithers, I had one instance like that. I have a parishioner who is, the lady is Catholic, the husband is not, but he always comes to church. Yes? Yes, Father Babji. Yes, my request for those who are participating via online is that you click your mute button for your microphone so that we don't hear your conversations or any noise surrounding you, because it can be very sensitive. And that's Father Babji from Gidima. Thank you for saying that. Okay, where am I? Yes, I had a parishioner in Smithers, and then I had to phone the bishop and say, would this be something that you will allow? And it was allowed, so it happened. And it provides a different atmosphere in the community that people, so that we can accommodate such instance, you know? Okay, so from there, knowing who are entitled of, or who has the right for Christian funeral liturgy, I will now go on to the three celebrations that should take place whenever a Christian person dies. Okay? So, and by the way, if you have questions, save that, and we'll give you opportunity to ask those questions later. But if you think it needed to be answered right now, then raise your hand. Okay? So, there are three celebrations to the order of Christian funerals. First is the vigil, and I will explain this in detail later on. Then, the funeral liturgy itself, it's either a funeral mass or funeral liturgy without mass. And then the rite of comito, which is usually at the gravesite. Okay. Now, what happens, or what is the vigil? The vigil is the gathering of the family and friends of the deceased before the funeral mass. You know, it's interesting to note the language of the church's document. I noticed this after I read all the things that I need to read before I make a presentation. I'd like you to take note of that word, family and friends, because later on, the language will be slightly different. Okay? The vigil is a gathering of the family and friends of the deceased. It is a wake or prayer service. Usually, and in some other tradition, praying of the rosary is major part of it. You know, for instance, for again, I can only speak for my own experience, the Italian and the Portuguese. Praying the rosary during the vigil is a very important part of the vigil service. And it usually happens on the day preceding the funeral, usually the night before. And then it can be held in the church, in a funeral home, or home of the deceased. You know, speaking about the wake or the vigil, most of you would know that I am a Filipino. I came from the Philippines. And wake for us can be a very extended period of time. It could be 3, 5 days or a week. And it's really an opportunity for family and friends to visit and to remember the deceased loved one. It's an opportunity. And really, later on, I'll be talking about eulogy or words of remembrance. In the mind of the church, this is a very appropriate time for people to share their words of remembrance about the person who died. About the person who died. This is the very first place where we encourage it to happen. The eulogy or words of remembrance. And there are two other places where it can be done, and I will share that with you later. Now, and I also would present to you the brief outline of the rite towards the end of my presentation. Now, we go to the funeral liturgy itself on the day where supposedly the second part. I told you earlier, notice the words. Earlier, it says it's a gathering of family and friends. Here, it says, the church gathers with the family and friends. It's not just a family gathering anymore. You know, because each of us is baptized. Because each of us belongs to a particular parish church. And so therefore, when somebody dies, me as a brother, Christian, needs to support that grieving family. Because we belong to that same church. You know, it's not just, even if I don't know the person, but because that person goes to that church, he or she is part of the community. So the church gathers with that family and with friends. We may not necessarily be direct friends of that, but we're brothers and sisters in the faith. So we have an obligation as belonging to that particular community to be there, to show support to that grieving family. You know? And so that's a change of language I was talking about. Why do we gather this funeral liturgy? First, to give praise and thanks to God for Christ's victory over sin and death. Remember earlier? In the face of death, we proclaim that Christ, the Paschal mystery, that Christ will raise us. To commend the deceased to God's tender mercy and compassion. I'll give you an example of the prayer that we usually hear whenever there is a funeral. It's beautiful. It says, for instance, a collect. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant who has fallen asleep in Christ may rejoice to rise again through him. And then the prayer over the offerings, for instance. As we humbly present to you the sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge. In the time of death, we hope that our Lord will really manifest, will really show his mercy upon us. And that is reflected in the prayer of the church. So during the funeral liturgy, we commend our deceased loved one to God's tender mercy and compassion. And hopefully, we will find a merciful judge in him. And lastly, to seek strength in the proclamation of the Paschal mystery. And while we do respect as a church that the family is grieving, remember that it is a funeral liturgy, usually a celebration of Mass, then it is also an act of worship. It is also an act of worship and not just merely an expression of grief. You know, earlier I said the funeral liturgy can be funeral Mass or funeral liturgy outside Mass. As a Catholic, the number one rule is that you deserve a funeral Mass. We all deserve a funeral Mass when we die. But there are circumstances that, you know, we call it for pastoral reasons, maybe Mass cannot be offered right away. I'll give you an example. For instance, I die and the rest of my family are no longer practicing their faith and they become a stranger to the church. And then the rest of the people whom my family would be expecting to attend my funeral would have no knowledge about Catholic faith and the Mass. Rather than embarrassing those people, the priests who will celebrate my funeral could celebrate Mass separately for the eternal repose of my soul. But rather, we would just offer the funeral liturgy outside Mass. And that is out of respect for both the liturgy and both the people who will be gathered. I think that could be one reason why there could be a funeral Mass or funeral outside the Mass, because of that reason. These quotations that I'm giving enclosed on the parenthesis, the yellow or gold label there, you will be provided with the handout later on, where there will be more detail of what I'm saying. Okay? Yes. Okay. Now we move on from the funeral liturgy. We go to the rite of comital. This is the conclusion of the funeral rites. It may be celebrated at the grave, tomb, crematorium, or in a cemetery comital chapel. It is an expression of the communion that exists between the church on earth and the church in heaven. You know, when I hear these words, I just feel glad because it's so beautiful to be Catholic. Because I know that I'm not alone even in the time of death. It is an expression of the communion that exists between the church on earth and the church in heaven. You know, meaning to say, again, the prayers of the church would say, indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. So, when we die, it is a journey from here to there. We may not know when is that exact time, but our faith tells us that tells us that promise that one day we will reach heaven. We will reach heaven and we will all be reunited. So for now, there is that bond that exists between us and them. And when that's it usually affirmed and it happens in the celebration of the Eucharist, for instance. In the celebration of the Eucharist, I've been always saying, and the church is always saying, God is glorified, man is sanctified. And we are not the only ones celebrating. Whenever we celebrate the Holy Eucharist, the whole cosmos is celebrating with all the angels and saints above and with us here. Beautiful. Beautiful. Now, I go to address the eulogy or words of remembrance. Like I mentioned earlier, so what is eulogy or words of remembrance in the first place? These are special speeches, words of remembrance given in honor of the deceased, usually by a family member, a close friend, and usually, this is one of the parts where the family keeps negotiating. How long could this be? How many people? And where? And it's just hard sometimes to negotiate. But as far as the church is concerned, these are the proper places for words of remembrance. You know, at the conclusion of the vigil service, so the night before, before the funeral mass begins, which means to say, I was reading things in preparation for this, and I found that on June 27, 2006, I was still a seminarian, and I was part of that liturgy meeting with Father John Barden, and it says here, that time, it was recommended by the Liturgy Commission of the Diocese to the Council of Priests, that eulogies or words of remembrance can have a place just before the opening prayer during the actual funeral mass or liturgy. It says here, words of remembrance eulogies are to be in carriage of the vigil prayers or the reception after the funeral liturgy. So this reflects this, right? If this is not possible due to pastoral reasons, the words of remembrance are to be placed before the opening prayer. And I think I've been to many in this diocese that apparently, although this is not what is mandated, it is becoming common. And I would say, I mean, they use the word pastoral considerations, you know. And by the way, as I do all this presentation with you tonight, at the end of the day, it will be a conversation between your family and your pastor. Okay? For me, tonight, my goal is to provide us with a general understanding of what this is about. Okay? And then the other place for eulogy or words of remembrance is the following the prayers of committal at the cemetery. So you can also do that. At the springtime, maybe, or summer, but not during winter. Yes. So the words of remembrance, and if I may incorporate something here, again, a part of my readings, you know, nowadays also PowerPoint becoming part of all these things. I would say that should be part of the this following the prayers during the reception or the conclusion of the vigil service. Why? Again, if we just remember the structure of the funeral mass, it's the celebration of the Eucharist. We just do not want to disturb that structure. And so, let's be mindful of that. It's not, the church does not say, the church say no to that for a reason. It's not because we do not want to accommodate it, but there is a good reason for that. And the good reason for that, for one, is we do not want to disturb the structure of the Mass. You know? And there is a rightful place where people are more flexible and free, especially I've been to places where there is even an open microphone. You know, can you imagine, for instance, if the church allows these eulogies to go on and on and on, and so you don't know when will this be finished? For instance, on Sunday Mass, people are so used to finish, you know, we need to finish the Mass within an hour. If I'm not able to finish the Mass within an hour, I'm sure you are not coming back the following Sunday. Right? So let's apply that same kind of practical principle in the funeral. And that these people who are attending your funeral, although they want to, you know, be part of the church, they want to express their sorrow with the family, we're also taking their time. And so let's, you know, all these little considerations, but I think there are beautiful reasons why the church is saying there is another place for eulogy or words of remembrance. And if we will accommodate it at Mass, then let's try to be very considerate of the structure of the Mass. Matter of fact, the guidelines coming from BC bishops and Yukon, the bishops of British Columbia and Yukon, even said that eulogies of the, or these words of remembrance should be shared or presented to the pastor, to the priest presiding at the funeral, so that, I guess that's for many reasons. One would be length, but at the same time, we just want to make sure that, again, mindful that this is in the context of the liturgy inside the church, then we just don't want, you know, sometimes I've been to all the sharing of eulogies and it becomes like just a laughing session, right? So, anyway.
Father Vicarino?
Yes,
Father. Let's make a comment. There's also sometimes a practical reason. I know from my experience at the cathedral downtown, we would have Mass at noon. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes it's difficult for families to understand that the priest is also under obligations to, yes, you know, for other commitments.
Yes.
And so that can sometimes be a reason why we have to limit, yes, the amount of time that words of remembrance can be shared.
Yes, thank you, Father, for pointing that out. And fathers who are here, anything that you think needs a supplement from you, please do so. Thank you. Now I move on to the issue of cremation. Here, in my readings, I would say, compliment to the busy bishops and Yukon. This is one of the things that triggered my presentation as well, that the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith came up, apparently, with a new document on Christian burial and cremation. When I was reading it, really, to be honest with you, and no offense to the Holy Mother Church, there's nothing new. There's nothing new in this document, except that the church would like to remind us of what really the church is expecting from us whenever we do the cremation, you know? Let me read this first. The Code of Canon Law says, "The church earnestly recommends that the pious custom of burying the bodies of the deceased be observed. Nevertheless, the church does not prohibit cremation unless it was chosen for reasons contrary to Christian doctrine." Okay? So the church always has allowed it, but with certain limitation. You know, if you tell me, for instance, that, okay, we would like his body to be cremated, and after that, we will distribute it somewhere. And then I would say, I hope I did not hear it. Because I would be inclined to say, and again, this is the mind of the church, this is not just Father Rector. I would be inclined to say, sorry, this is contrary to what the church is expecting us. You know, the church has this position. Give the same dignity as you would give the same dignity to the ashes as you would give it to the body. Now, if we take all those words literally, you will not break the leg. We are 11 in the family. I cannot tell to my brothers and sisters, I will have the leg of my mom, you will have the arm, you will have the head, and all of that. In the same way that we should not be distributing these ashes, with all due respect to the funeral homes present here, the representative of the funeral homes. Nowadays, I think it's becoming common, for instance, that, again, for the reason that siblings wanted, they all wanted to have something of their parents, for instance, of their loved one. Funeral homes would come up with a pendant, you know, that they could put a little amount of ashes of their ashes of their parents. And I just want to tell us, that's not consistent to what the church expects of a Catholic. If that's what will happen, you know, if that's a reason for cremation, then I would say, according to the mind of the church, there is a reason for the church to say, no. And we need to just know that. Again, it could be there could be a dialogue there between the pastor and your family, but my objective tonight is to present us with what the church is. This is not coming from me. This is not only coming from me, but this is the mind of the church. So, why don't I just simply grab that letter K of the busy bishops? It is the priest's responsibility to verify the proper motivation and to determine that those arranging for the funeral have made satisfactory provision for the cremated remains, preferably in a Catholic cemetery. When these required conditions are met, the various elements of the Catholic funeral rite are conducted in the usual way. The body of the deceased should be present for the funeral mass. So ideally, this is the mind of the church. Before cremation, the funeral liturgy has been completed or done. But I know too that for economic reasons, what people are now usually doing is, yes, they dialogue with their pastor and they say that transparently, honestly, and they say, you know, for economic reason, Father, we decide that we will cremate and we'll have the church service. There is a room for that. It says here, although ordinarily the body is present for the funeral, there may be occasions when, with the approval of the bishop, it is permitted to celebrate the funeral liturgy, including the Eucharist, in the presence of the ashes of the deceased. In this case, the ashes are to be placed on a small table covered with a white cloth. The table is placed in front of the altar, not in the place that the casket usually occupies, but a little to the side. The pastoral candle, holy water, and incense may be used. The alternative form of the dismissal is used. Cremated remains should never be scattered. Placed in a worthy container, they should be buried in a grave or inurned in a columbarium niche, preferably in a Catholic cemetery. So, be mindful of that. You know, what is another sad thing that is happening around us? We are faithful Catholic, if we may categorize ourselves. Not that we are raising ourselves here tonight. But there could be those of our family members who are not and may not belong, may no longer be practicing Catholic at the time of our death. And it's so important to write these things because nowadays you read in the newspaper, no funeral service. You know? So I will grieve double if I am your pastor and I see you regularly at Mass, you know, and then during the time of death, your family will just say, no funeral service. You deserved. It is your right to have funeral Mass as a Catholic. So write that somewhere. Okay? Now, I like to go with the different elements of the liturgical celebration. This might be of interest to our brothers and sisters working at the funeral home as well, so that you kind of gauge the length of the celebration. Liturgical elements, the Word of God. In all those celebrations, the vigil, the funeral Mass, even our funeral liturgy outside Mass, and the rite of committal, incorporated in all of those are the Word of God. The Word of God. And so, later on you will be given something just for you as a guide. And that's limited for participants. We're not mandating anything. But we're giving you something so that for you to consider as you plan your... In a matter of fact, I'm so happy with all of you. You're all brave to die. Because you're here. Thank you for being here. So the Word of God, it's important. And, for instance, before we do not have this book, you know, but the church, again, it's very beautiful to be part of the church, Holy Mother Church. They help us. So now there is this book where there is a compilation of the, it says here, ritual and votive masses. And one of those ritual masses would be for Mass for the Dead. And there are compilation of readings where you can choose readings or your family can choose readings from. So know that there is such a material. So if you are having a lazy afternoon and you want to really plan your death, prayers and intercessions, there are also different options for that. You know, again, during the time of death, the family who are grieving, they just don't know what to do. Because the focus, the high emotion at that moment is that they're feeling lonely, they're feeling sad. And so, it's useful that the church is offering us all of this. Even the prayer and intercessions, there are options. So again, if you have an access to this book at some point in your journey, feel free to borrow it. As a matter of fact, this is for borrowing. We have a library here. Okay. Music is an integral part of the celebration as well. Again, this is another thing that it's always been a point for people to negotiate. Because, for instance, somebody has a favorite secular song and they want to play it at the funeral. But listen to this, my dear sisters and brothers. Music is integral to the funeral rites. It allows the community to express convictions and feelings that words alone may fail to convey. It has the power to console and uplift the mourners and to strengthen the unity of the assembly in faith and love. The texts of the songs chosen for a particular celebration should express the Paschal mystery of the Lord's suffering, death, and triumph over death, and should be related to the readings from Scripture. Unfortunately, this is another thing that is regulated by the church when we die, the choice of songs. So, and what are the options that are given to us? In the Catholic Book of Worship, there is a good selection. And again, in my research, in preparation for this, I thank the previous Liturgy Commission of the Diocese because I found this. funeral rites, guidelines for preparation by the Prince George. And towards the end of this material, which happened to be unpublished, by the way, but the pastors in different parishes has this, it gives us several choices for music, you know, that people can choose from. So for sure, we will review this and we'll make this available for the people in the diocese. Because what happened was, this was a finished work, if I may understand, Father John, I think, and Martha, they were part of creation of this document. But it was approved by the Council of Priests in 2010. I was already priest then. And it did not get published because that's the time that Bishop Jerry had an accident. And so it has something to do with that. It got distributed, though, to the priests at that time. But I would say I have perused it, and there are many good elements of this, and I thank those people before me who work hard to produce this document. And there are lots of... Basically, you know, we're all getting from the same sources, but it's being localized in our own diocese for our own application. And so, for instance, tonight I'm trying to hit everybody here. There are priests, there are people who've been at home, there are different individuals. My attempt is just to give you general information. But when you go to your parish, for instance, this material also provides sheets for the actual planning of that actual day. Whereas the material that I will give you later on will just points that you can scribble for your family to consider. But this one, the things that are compiled here are for actual preparation, for the actual planning already and execution, if I may understand it right, Father. Mm-hmm. Would you like to make any comments? Because your name is attached
so long.
But you were part of the people who were here. Thank you. Okay. Music. That's with regards to music. So be mindful of that. You cannot just play your favorite song at your funeral, apparently. I'm sorry to disappoint you. Okay? Silence is a good... this is a good element of our Eucharistic celebration as well. Reverential silence. Reverential silence. It's always feeling kind of dramatic when, for instance, at the prayer of commendation, the priest will say a prayer and there is a little pause there. You know, like a pause that Canadians do, for instance, during Remembrance Day. It's a good pause where people are invited to pray for the deceased. Other symbols would be Easter candle and other candles. So we have a display here. Again, this is the beauty of our faith. You would remember that when we were baptized, we were given that light as a sharing to the light of Christ, received the light of Christ. And so during our death, the Lord is present. He's there. The pastor candle, the Easter candle. It proclaims to us that, again, we die with Him, we will rise with Him. And even in the darkness of death, Christ shed its light upon us. What else are other symbols? Holy water, the water of baptism. Again, when your body is welcome, the reception of the church before the funeral liturgy begins, or at the beginning of the funeral liturgy, you are sprinkled with holy water. And then before the final commendation, or during the final commendation, the body is sprinkled with holy water. If we connect the two, the baptism and, you know, our going, our journey to heaven, we see that this is all connected. There is opening, it puts it together, you know. And then, what else are the symbols? The incense. The incense is our prayer that rises up to God. But in my reading, it also is to honor the body. You know, we incense it. It's so helpful to read that even with the ashes, the busy bishops say it can be used, the incense and holy water. Next slide. Other symbols would be, this is a funeral pall, again related to our baptism. When we were baptized, we were clothed with white garment. When we die, this big white cloth is draped over our casket. You know, there can be many beautiful meaning that can be drawn there, from there. In death, we are all equal. Whether you are powerful or not today, whether you are rich or not today, in death, we will all lay flat and we will all be equal in the eyes of God. That's what this funeral pall would symbolize. Book of the Gospel is displayed here because you can also put that on top of the casket on the vigil service. But when the funeral liturgy, when the actual day starts, it should be removed. And same with the symbol of the cross. They can be put during the vigil service, but on the actual day, it will be removed because basically it will be replaced by the funeral pall. And the fresh flowers, with all due respect to the emotion and sentiments that are attached to it, I would say don't overdo it for many reasons. One would be economic. Flowers is so expensive. You know, there are traditions, again with all due respect, that they put a spray on top, and we discourage that. We discourage that. My experience, brothers and sisters, I tell them, okay, during the funeral planning, tell me all your plans. I will want surprises, because when you surprise me, I will also surprise you. And they tell me everything. So it's a happy funeral. Yeah. Anyway, so then the liturgical color that's just white to symbolize resurrection, but to correct the term, the funeral liturgy, the funeral mass, is not mass of the resurrection. It's not a celebration of life either, okay? It's a funeral mass. That's our term as a Catholic, okay? So, what else? I think, it says here funeral offerings because it is also addressed in the document, and I'll just like to read it, letter L, because this could be a concern to some as well. Funeral offerings. An offering to the parish for funeral services is customary and may be suggested according to the approved diocesan schedule for such offerings. However, a funeral service including Mass in the church with the body present and a committal service is given to the poor free of charge. What I read is consistent with the law of the church. What I read is from the busy bishops. This is from the canon law. Okay? Other pastoral elements that we need to consider, that we need to advise others when planning for our funeral. And this is on letter M of this document, which you will have. Proper coordination with the priest or pastor. Sometimes, or there were times where it's already publicized in the newspaper when it's the funeral, but it's not well coordinated with the pastor or with the priest in charge. So proper coordination is a key before you make any specific plans. And of course, pre-arrange plans for funeral and cemetery needs. You know, you don't want to put your family into that difficult situation where they have to decide for you, where in fact, you could have made that decision for yourself when you are still strong and alive, you know. So they're already grieving. Don't add that part of, okay, being concerned, okay, where will we bury this person? Yeah. So, pre-arrange plans for funeral and cemetery needs. And there are funeral representatives here. I asked them for their business card to be distributed later on. Mass and prayers for the deceased. We believe on the communion of saints and for praying for the dead. So, therefore, even as today, we should not neglect offering mass intention for our deceased loved ones, because they can no longer pray for themselves. We can. Gives to worthwhile charities in memory of the deceased. You know, since I came to Canada, this become more obvious to me that when a person dies, he or she can decide to say, in lieu of flowers, give donation to, you know, to these charities. Later on, you will receive forms that I adapted from other dioceses where I put all our charities here in the Diocese of Prince George. And that's just, if you're a good Catholic, please remember the Catholic Church before you come. That's part of our stewardship. That's part of our stewardship. Okay? I know you remember other institutions, but please remember us as well. Okay?
Remember your parish.
Other pastoral considerations and or suggestion. I would say, you know, this is for advising the funeral homes. You know, people come up with prayer card or order of service, you know, the little thing that gets distributed to people. How I wish, as a priest, and maybe as a person who is just simply attending a funeral of someone, how I wish those things that gets distributed is useful for me right at that service, where there is that order of service, where I know what is happening. Keep in mind that all Catholics are in that service. So we need to guide them. So hopefully you can incorporate that in your suggestion to family, and not just a story of the, with all due respect, you know, not just story, not just poem, not just a song that were quoted somewhere without permission, you know. So just put the order of service and who's doing which. It's useful. Let's make it useful for people. Especially, I know for a fact, to produce those things is expensive. So we might as well make it useful for the users. Forming bereavement group in the parish, for those of you who are quite involved in the parishes, this is one of my limitation or frustrations as well. When I was in Smithers, I was hoping I can form a bereavement committee or ministry to journey with me with those who are grieving, but I was not able to do it. I know for a fact that Christ the King in Kitimat has this group who are journeying with grieving family. So it's beautiful because, again, it communicates that the person is a member of the church. The person is a member of the church. That they are not alone, even in the time of death. They're part of the body of Christ. This is mostly for us, priests, burial permit recording. So funeral homes issue it, we take it, we keep the record. For it becomes part of a record that this really take place, because it can be useful at some point. Okay? Yes.
And just one step further, fathers, that the government will inspect at some point the churches to make sure that they are there, because it is part of the law.
Yes.
That those permits are.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. So, yeah. Okay. So I will just quickly walk us through the outline of the rites. We don't necessarily need to dwell on this too much, but I just want to show you the outline of each rite that has been mentioned. The vigil, the funeral service, the funeral liturgy, and the rite of committal. This is what happened during the vigil. Okay? Up back. Greeting, invitation, reading. Okay? The word of God is always part of it. And then you can insert there the eulogy. Next. Vigil of the deceased with rite reception at the church. The introductory rite, liturgy of the word, prayer of intercession, concluding rite. And if you move along, this is what is composed of the introductory rite. This will be more for us planning the liturgy, the actual funeral, where the body will already be received, you know. So, keep going. The funeral mass, That's the actual structure. Thank you. And this is what happened at the cemetery. The the grave is blessed as well. And so I think that's how I will end my presentation, and you will be given time for question and answer. But before we break, I'll give you a copy of this. And again, before I did this presentation, I was having dinner tonight. And those online participants already received this ahead of time. Bishop Jensen is one of those. And he has not seen my material. But he caught my attention after, and he said, "Do you have a minute?" And so he phoned me and said, "There are two things here that I would like to provide some clarification as you open it." There is a portion here where it says, "When I die, I want viewing or not." So, or open casket. Apparently, with all humility, I would say that I was told viewing is not necessarily part of our Catholic tradition. And then the other thing that was pointed out to me was the choosing of liturgical ministers. The choosing of liturgical ministers, usually, as much as the liturgy calls for your participation, but you cannot just choose someone who is not prepared to do it. You know, you cannot assign someone to read if we know that that person is not actually reading at Mass, because you're putting that person into an awkward situation when you die. You know, so again, whatever you find in that package is just for a guide. It says their sample. Okay, yes, Father.
I just want to say, it's my understanding that viewings, of course, can happen, but where it can get difficult with families sometimes, and you don't want to be harsh with them, is once the funeral liturgy begins, the casket must be closed, and it remains closed.
Yeah.
Because we will get requests to open up the casket again at the end of the funeral mass, which is not...
So while we acknowledge, thank you, Father John, while we acknowledge that's our view about viewing, there are times where it is so difficult because the family keep requesting. There are times where, you know, when we're already celebrating the funeral liturgy, we cannot leave it open, you know. So... I found something here, which I will quote anyway. It says, if I may be allowed to read it before I dismiss it for a break. "It is not uncommon for families to request a final viewing after the funeral liturgy is over and before the final commendation and burial, especially if some people arrive after the start of the funeral when the casket was already closed. Pastors should be sensitive to this request, lest family members become over distraught because they did not have the opportunity to view the body." I'm hearing this is that there is a rightful place for viewing. But I'm also hearing what Bishop Jensen is saying, that in the structure, it's not part of it. We need to fit it in somewhere. We need to fit it in somewhere. You know, yes.
Father, and from a funeral director's point of view, there's inconsistency with the priest too. Like, some priests will let you do certain things and others won't. For example, in one church, we have to process in the night of the viewing or the prayer service, but no other church asked us to do that.
Yeah.
Now, once we process in and the pall is on, then the priest doesn't allow any other opportunity for travelers the next morning, maybe before the Mass. So the inconsistency from a funeral director's point of view
Thank you for pointing that
very
out.
Difficult.
And that's why I walk us briefly with the outline of the rite. Can you show the vigil with the reception of the body? Because I think that priest is coming from this perspective.
Okay.
And rightly so. Mm-hmm. If the body is being brought already towards the end, if the body is being brought already to the church the night before, mm-hmm. I would think that body should also be, should already be received. Rather than, okay, let's do the vigil service and we'll do the reception of the body tomorrow. You know? So keep in mind that the nature of vigil service can happen at the funeral home or at home. That's why if it happens in the church, then the reception of the body should already take place and not delay it the following day. So I would say that, and I can understand you say priests are doing it all differently, with all due respect to my brother priests, because probably we are not all reading the same material.
Yes,
I'm sorry to say that.
Yeah, but what happens is because we're used to how it goes in the majority of the churches, and all of a sudden you're faced with this, and the family even has no idea. And now the priest says that casket is never opened again, and the family just is ready to fall on the floor.
It is especially difficult here in the city of Prince George, where there are four parishes.
Yes,
I don't have any of these problems.
And oblates and diocesan.
What's that?
And oblates and diocesan.
Oblates and diocesan.
No, there's a difference. There is.
Yes.
There is.
Okay.
From our perspective, from my perspective.
Okay. Yes.
For sure.
Yes. Thank you for your observation. I will make sure I deliver that to my brother priest with much sensitivity. Any other observations before we break?
Now, did you say that if I want Father John to officiate at my funeral,
good point.
How do I do that?
Good point. It's actually your pastor's obligation to bury you.
Yes.
It's your pastor's obligation to bury you. That's just the role of the pastor. But for instances where the pastor is not available, or you are really very close to that particular priest for one reason or another, so then the priests also negotiate. And I've been to a funeral of one or two because I was requested to. And so then I had to get permission from the pastor. The pastor has to give that permission.
Father?
Yes, Father?
Can I just comment on that, please?
Sure.
I just asked people, because it's very, you know, it's very humbling, and it's very, I mean, it is truly beautiful when people do want you to pray with their family and preside over your funeral, where you've journeyed with the parish and what you've moved on. I just, you know, if you can share the message out there in your communities, it can place the priest sometimes in a difficult situation, though. Because once we move on, as Father just addressed there, we are no longer the pastor. Mm-hmm. So I know I've had that experience where I have felt extremely guilty and sad, but I've had to say no to families because I did journey with them and I came close to them. But I have to also be attentive to the fact that I'm not the pastor, and we can sometimes step on the toes mm-hmm. of another brother priest who may not appreciate the fact that we are coming back into now their parish. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that, you know, if a priest that you love says no to you at some point, please understand that he may be saying no for various reasons.
Yes. Thank you for your clarification. You and then.
So would the asking to co-celebrate be the way to get around that?
It ultimately depends on the pastor of the parish. He has the right to say whether another priest is coming into his parish or not.
Right, but being that the church is the people, you're coming to pay your respects to the deceased.
Exactly.
But he would does you have, not be...
But in the eyes of the church, he has jurisdiction over that parish.
So
still, I go there and say, Father, may I concelebrate?
Right.
I'm coming here I will use your word, to pay respect to my friend, but will you allow me to concelebrate? And usually, we're brother priests, we live in peace and we dialogue, so we pay respect to each other. Yeah. So, yeah. Yes.
I was curious whether or not the church gives any direction to families or funeral directors when they're planning a Catholic funeral about who they're choosing to assist with Mass, particularly with readings, music, etc. Quite often families draw from their family members, but quite often those family members are no longer or never were practicing Catholics. Mm-hmm. And I've been to a number of funerals where somebody is basically invited into the holiest part of our parish, into the sanctuary, to proclaim the word, and everybody there knows they are living their life so contrary to the faith and to what the deceased believes that it's a scandalous thing for them to be there. And I know you don't want to tread on the hearts of people that are in the midst of grief, but this particular portion of the funeral isn't really about them.
That's right. And that's what I was trying to say earlier, that as much as you have your own preference, who reads at your funeral, who does things at your funeral, at that time, we're dead. We have no control over it. But then the family may be asked for a consideration. But I like your point. The priest should be knowledgeable enough and sensitive enough to determine, okay, would this be an appropriate choice? Because like you said, and it does say in this document, as much as we want to involve people, because ministry to death, it's also a ministry of participation among the faithful, but we be mindful as well of the general expectation that those who are doing, we're not uplifting ourselves when we say this, those who are doing particular ministry in the celebration of the Mass, should be living lives consistent to what the church expects of us. You know, the other side of that is, asking too much from a family member or relatives can really be asking too much. We're putting into a difficult situation a person who is already grieving, and we want to avoid that. It boils down to the actual planning between the pastor and the family. One new discovery while doing all of this is, as a priest, you know, we should not be calling family to come to us when they have a deceased member who dies. We should visit them. We should visit them, and that's where the planning should take place. Again, respecting all the limitations that are in place. Yes.
Father, back to the beginning of your presentation regarding who qualifies for the funeral service in the church.
Yes.
I'm thinking of, you mentioned that if there was an intention of baptizing the child, yes. What if there is not an intention of baptizing the child, and they might even be school kids, you know?
Yes.
But the extended family would like a burial, and the parents agree to that. What's the position of the church
then? I think that the position of the church allows for that.
Okay. For an actual Mass.
You said extended family.
Yeah.
One way or another, there must be someone related to the baby who died to make these requests. This should not be a request just coming from, you know. So I think the church allows for that. Thank you for pointing that out. Yes,
and also just, you know, we do believe in three forms of baptism. Baptism by water, by martyrdom, and by desire. That third one is important, you know, because I had the experience of a teenager, for example, who died tragically. It was given through the parents, there was all indications that there was a desire there, that that young man wanted to be in relationship with God. So we therefore had a funeral. Right, so priests, pastoral life directors need to also take that into account, that there are different forms of baptism, not just by water.
Well, thanks again for having me. So my name is Carolyn Burkholder. I'm a lawyer here in Prince George at Heather Savage Jenkins. I am also a practicing Catholic. My family and I attend Immaculate Conception. I used to go to St. Joseph's because I'm from Damagoo. So today I'm just going to take you through quite briefly because I want to leave lots of time for questions. I got the impression lots of people had things they want to ask about, and I'm sure you have questions for me as well. So I'm first going to talk a bit about estate planning, things that you do prior to death, and then I'll talk a little bit about what happens after you die in terms of the law. So first I'm going to talk about a will, which is one of the most important documents you can leave behind for your loved ones. So the will has basically six components, or there's six kind of main purposes for having a will. So the first thing that a will does is it names someone to be your executor. So the executor is in charge of administering your estate, determining what your assets are, paying off your debts, holding money in trust for minor beneficiaries, and dealing with probate application, things like that. So when you're looking to name an executor, you're going to think about who's good at that kind of thing, who's good at paperwork. Think of maybe someone and then an alternate, someone who's likely to survive you, especially if you travel with your spouse a lot, it's good to name an alternate. Another purpose for a will is to name beneficiaries. So beneficiaries are the people that inherit through you, like your heirs. So that would be your loved ones. Of course, keep in mind the Diocese of Prince George. So charities, your loved ones, things like that. So that's a really important part of your will as well. The next thing is to do trust. A trust is basically is when money is held by someone for the benefit of someone else. The most common trusts are testamentary trusts, which means they're set out in a will. I'm going to use myself as an example because I have small children. So if my husband and I were both to die, leave behind our small children, you're not going to turn around to my one-year-old and say, here, have half of your parents' estate. That would just be silly. So what, under BC law, you can't inherit till you turn 19. So that money would be held by somebody. The executor would hold that money for their good, and they could pay their tuition to attend IC school, or they could pay for their hockey, things like that, or release money to their guardian, which brings me to the next point of having a will, which is for people like me, which is to name a guardian for your kids. So that's a really important aspect as well. Also, the reason a lot of people draft wills is you want to give a lot of powers to your executor. So often people will ask me, oh, I did a will-kit will. Is that fine? Is that legal? And the answer is yes. Wills don't need to be notarized, and they don't need to be drafted by a lawyer. They need to be witnessed by two people. The two people cannot be beneficiaries on the will and ideally shouldn't be related to you at all. So two completely different people. You sign, they sign. That makes a valid will. The problem with some of the will kit wills, number one, there can be issues like it wasn't set up appropriately for your family situation, particularly if you have disabled beneficiaries, things like that. Another issue is they often don't give a lot of powers to the executor. You want to give them a broad scope of things they can do, deal with your property, deal with take out insurance on your belongings, deal with a lawsuit if you're involved in a lawsuit, deal with your business if you're a business owner. Just the broader powers, the better. And the last one is to set out your funeral wishes. So sometimes people choose not to put those in the will, and that's fine. You do not have to. But if you have very strong opinions, particularly if you are Catholic, if your family is not Catholic, if you want a Catholic funeral, make sure that goes in your will as well. So that's dealing with the will, and those are kind of the six most important points about that. Other documents that we recommend that people have and leave for their loved ones are things called powers of attorney. So that's, the power of attorney is when you're still alive, but that would be in the case where you say you're incapacitated, coma, dementia. It allows someone to deal with your legal and financial affairs, so your bank accounts, your property, paying for your care, things like that. Another document is called a representation agreement. A lot of people think that powers of attorney are for your medical decisions, and here in BC it's actually a separate document called a representation agreement. Most people don't need those, and most people don't have those. The reason is because here in British Columbia, the law sets out who is legally entitled to make those medical decisions for you if you're not able to make them yourselves. And something really important with that is, oh, I'll take you through who it is, and then I'll tell you why that's important. So the first person would be your spouse, if you have a spouse, and they have capacity, which means they're not prone to dementia. The second would be adult children, if you have adult children, together, not the oldest to the youngest, in order it's your adult children as a group. Then it'd be parents, if you still have parents, and then it kind of goes on from there to siblings and down kind of your family tree. The reason we draft those for people is if they want to, say, get a friend to make their medical decisions. The other reason is if they don't want someone in that line to do it. Say they don't get along with one of their adult children, something like that, then they can, you can change the order by drafting this document. It's very important, especially as Catholics, that you let people know what your medical wishes are. By law, they're supposed to take into account your expressed wishes, which means if you write it down and give it to them, so the people that would be making those decisions, that's the best thing you can do, because the idea is that they have to go by what your expressed wishes are. If you don't do, failing that, they're going to look at things like your belief system, which is important, because as Catholics, we have opinions on that. And also your best interest in failing that. So the best thing you can do is make people aware of what the Catholic Church's teachings are if they're not practicing Catholics, or and write down your wishes. So that's the documents you draft prior to death. I'm just going to take you really briefly through what happens after death. So most of you, some of you, have probably dealt with a loved one's death and the legal ramifications, probate applications, things like that, but I'll just take you through it briefly. So probate is a court application that happens when someone dies. It's required for almost everyone, not everyone. So the things that make you go through probate are if you own assets of $25,000 or more in just your name, and that's cumulative. So it includes your bank accounts and your car and your property, things like that. Or if you own real property, so like a piece of land or a house, just by yourself, it doesn't matter the value that triggers, that makes you go through probate. So basically, probate is a court application. You don't actually have to go to court. You just file documents with the court. You'll file a copy of the will if there was one. You'll file a copy of the will search notice, which is through the vital statistics to see if you had a registered will. You'll file a copy of the notice that notified your beneficiaries or your next of kin. You'll file a document setting out what all your assets were when you die. And then you pay a fee based on the value of those assets. And so what happens is you file the documents with the court, get back probate, and then you go ahead and administer the estate. So that's how that's dealt with. So should I open it up for questions for you or for me or for...
Is there a question for you?
Does anyone have any questions for me? Yes.
Is there a difference between a power of attorney and an enduring power of attorney?
Well, our policy at my law firm is to always just draft enduring powers of attorney. So there's two kinds of powers of attorney. This gets a little complicated. One is called a springing power of attorney, which means it comes into effect if a person loses capacity and then goes out of effect if the person regains capacity. Those are a bit complicated because capacity can be fluid, and it's also very difficult to determine capacity. We drafted enduring powers of attorney, which means they're valid upon signing, and they would continue to endure if someone loses capacity. So again, that's coma dementia. We keep them in our office. If someone needs to use them, they can use them with either the person's written permission, which means their mind is completely fine. Say they're in bed with a broken leg and they can't get to their bank account, so they can sign and say, hey, I want my spouse or my child to be able to go and use my bank account on my behalf for my good. Or if they come in with a doctor's note saying this person's lost capacity and you need those documents. So yeah, there are two types, and that's the difference. Yes?
So how do you know someone has a will, and when is it read?
Sorry, how do you know when someone has one?
Yeah,
end?
Like a parent dies or your sibling or whatever, how do they know they have a will, and when would you read it?
When would you read it? So a lot of people think the will reading is a big thing. They come into the lawyer's office and it all gets read. It's usually not that formal. Usually people have a copy of it stored in their basement and they just look at it themselves.
Yeah.
So usually that's what happens. How do you know when people have a will? So there is a wills registry here in BC. Not all wills are registered, so that's unreliable, but that's a good place to start, is you can check the registry, see if they had a registered will. Also, when anyone, ever anyone comes in with me to draft a will, I say, please tell your loved ones that it is here. Or we retain the originals in our office, but we give people copies, and the copies are stamped, and they say, original, at Heather Sandler Jenkins. So then if they give them to their loved ones, even in a sealed envelope, or say, there was a sealed envelope with a copy of my will in my safety deposit box or in my drawer, then they'll at least know where the original is. But it can be difficult. When people come in to do an estate and they are saying that there was no valid will or there was no will, they have to sign an affidavit, which is a sworn statement saying, I've done a diligent search. There, I couldn't find one, but does that mean there isn't one? So it's quite difficult. So if you do have a will, make sure that people know about it.
And Carolyn, if you don't have a will, and now it's time to do the funeral, and the wishes in the will were a Catholic funeral, but none of the kids go to church anymore, and they're from all over the planet, and they come together and they say, we don't want to have a mass. We don't want to have a mass. None of us go to mass. We know Mom went to mass, but we don't want to do that. They can make an application to the registrar of the province if it's in their best interest as a family and change Mom's request.
Yeah, that's a really,
it's rare.
It's rare. And
but it can happen.
It's unfortunate when that happens, because the idea, wills are meant to be the person.
That's right.
They can be, people can apply to have them buried, and that opens up a whole can of worms. But, thank you for bringing that up, Tom. Yes.
Not so much a question, but a comment from a funeral home point of view.
Yes.
The worst place to put your will if you have only one copy is your safety deposit box if it's a signature account. Because your executor needs to have the death certificate to go and get that out of the bank. The bank's going to want to see a death certificate. But we issue that to the executor. We don't know who that is. It's a catch-22. So you don't want it somewhere where you have it only under your name in the safety deposit box, or it causes a huge problem for your family.
Absolutely true.
One other thing too, if you do put it in a safety deposit box, there are two keys usually. So give one of those keys to a member of your family, and they have signing rights so that they can.
If it's just in your name and it's your box and you put your will in there, that's the worst place for it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Where are these wills registered? That's the first time I've ever heard.
You can register them with the Department of Vital Statistics in Victoria.
Oh, it goes to Victoria.
Yeah, it's basically a form you fill out that goes to Victoria. The will does not go there, but then it says, I have a will and it is this place. And it was signed this day. So when someone does a search of the registry, that will pop up.
That's done by the law firm if you have a will done to them.
Yes.
And is there a cost to that?
Yes, there is. And I'm blanking on it, but it's something like 26 bucks.
Okay.
Like it's not.
$45 from Access BC.
Okay, thank you.
You're paying for the envelope to return it.
Thank you.
And it takes 2 weeks.
Yes.
I'm not sure I should be asking this or not, but we're in the process of changing our wills around. Is it beneficial for us to go to a notary, or should we be going to a lawyer?
Lawyers are able to set up more extensive by the policy. So lawyers are able to set up more extensive trust provisions, and that means the money being held for minors and for disabled beneficiaries, things like that. If that's something you're thinking about, then probably a lawyer is a better option. Otherwise, there's some wonderful notaries here in Prince George, so they do a just fantastic job.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Carmen. That's very helpful. Question earlier there with regards euthanasia. I would, for now, just to give a quick response to the question, not knowing the stand of the busy bishops, how to handle the funeral of those people who died through euthanasia, I would approach it on the perspective of suicide, okay, for now. In the past, the church did not permit the Christian burial of anyone who committed suicide. With the reforms of Vatican II, the church now permits the celebration of the funeral rites for those who have committed suicide. In the case of suicide, there is need for great sensitivity and compassion, placing an emphasis on God's mercy and love for the deceased. So I hope, yes, Father. Yeah.
And I think we always have to remember the funeral is for those left behind. You know, really, the funeral is for the family. Mm-hmm. And if they request a funeral for their deceased who died this way, I would do it. Mm-hmm. Whether the law said I could or not, I would do it pastorally. I'm an oblate, so I can do that. Yeah. I'm getting back a Grace Memorial for this. I'm the only one in town, though.
And there are some diocesan with oblate hearts.
That's right. That's right.
No, I think we just have to keep that in mind, that the funeral is really not for the deceased. They're dead.
Yeah.
You know, and they're offering the mass for them or whatever. But the funeral is for the family and friends, you know. And if they're uncomfortable with having mass, I have no problem with that. I will do a liturgy of the word. You know, as we talked about, offer mass separately for them. You know, so I mean, there's, we have to be open and flexible and so on. You know, it's a tough time for people. You know,
yes.
So.
Thank you, Father.
So, this is a point that I was going to try. So, back to Sergio said, you have unbaptized community family. Your 11 siblings or whoever, one's fallen from the flock. You really want a Catholic funeral for that person. He hasn't been to church forever. What's our right in that? Hasn't been baptized either. Where do we go as a community to a sibling that, or a parent that was a Catholic mom, a Protestant dad? As a community, the family all wants to celebrate.
Because the family is the Catholic.
The family is
the and
Catholic.
The person has never been.
Never been.
Father, doesn't it say, sorry, I'm just, because I was doing that reading earlier, doesn't it say that you can have a funeral
service,
the funeral rite without a mass for a non-Catholic?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
If the family is Catholic. Didn't it say, I think it was 1180 maybe, in canon law?
I'm just getting mixed situation where I'm reacting to something that is not happening yet. So it's more easy to make a response when the actual situation is there. Because your whole being is involved. Here, I may answer your question, but in the eyes, the perspective of what the law is saying, right? And that's my duty as a priest, to deliver that. But when we are in the right situation, just like Father Gilbert said, I think at the end of it, we will always try to accommodate the grieving family, but not compromise what the church teaches. The highlight, the tender compassion mercy of God. Well, if we stretch that mercy and compassion, then what you are trying to arrive at will probably happen. Right?
And I think we have to keep in mind the last clause of canon law. I don't have it to paraphrase in front of me, Father, but if you have it there, what does it emphasize?
Yeah.
Canon law is not does not exist for the sake of canon law. Canon law exists for the salvation of souls mm-hmm. and to bring people into the mercy of God. So we must always interpret canon law with an intention of understanding why the law has come into being. St. Thomas Aquinas, not that I'm a great expert on this, said, "As if laws do not serve a purpose, they are negligent and no longer exist." So laws are not just there for the sake of law. They are to serve a purpose. And if they no longer serve a purpose, then they no longer are applicable.
It's like this. It's like operating in the spirit of the law, not the letter of the law, so tight. Because my experience, and I've been Catholic all my life, I'm 62, I have nothing to lose at this point of my life, so I'm going to throw this out here for the rest of the people that come behind, is that all of our lives, we go to church and we're taught about the love of God. And then the day of the funeral comes years later, in my experience now from this side, and what I find is that I'm having to advocate on behalf of the family saying, "Father, don't you understand? They just want to have that little picture of their mom in the front because she's not there. And they just want to see her. Can't we have a little tiny picture?" And I advocate, knowing that I'm the one that's going to wear it, so that the family doesn't, I take the hit from the priest, whoever that might be, and at the end of the day, I'm disappointed as a Catholic because I think this is an opportunity to show the love of God, and yet they're being so tight with the law that there's no room for the love. And I'm not saying that happens occasionally, but I've seen many, many times in the last 15 years of doing this that the church is actually turning many people off. Because they're so tight, and I'm one of them that sits here now wondering if I would have my funeral in the Catholic Church. As much as I've been born and raised and grown up and still go to church, it's like, wow, that's kind of tight for me and all the people I've met in my lifetime. You know, and they know God too. So what's the best way to celebrate where my friends and family would feel they're really celebrating my life in that 1 hour? That's where comes a lot of anxiety and a lot of stress for families. So what you've taught us tonight, Father, I wish every Catholic could get this information, because I wouldn't have to be stressed. They'd understand. But it's us frontliners that are having.
But I thank you for your honest sharing, because I think you have raised many good points there that can be point for reflection for us on the side of those who represent the church. But allow me to give a comment just to address, and again, I approach it in the perspective of what the church expects of us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because if we allow these little things and view it as an expression of compassionate, accommodating, because they're grieving, then we will come to a point where we say, where do we draw the line? And everybody could come up with the strange requests. And where do we draw the line? Let's be mindful with your sisters and brothers. The law is there to protect us, not to make our life rigid or tight, but to protect us. With all due respect to many things that you have shared, sometimes these requests were brought by the fact that they have seen this somewhere else or in a movie. And the funeral, turning to become a Hollywood.
Yeah.
Hollywood wedding, Hollywood funeral.
Yeah.
Again, with all due respect. So that's why we have, I love that we have the structure. Because it protects us. But having said that, in executing this, the compassionate, the merciful side should be present. The document calls for pastoral sensitivity. That's the term used by the document. Pastoral sensitivity.
It would be awesome if this was taught right from the pulpit in all of the churches, and if there was a meeting, the funeral directors could be invited to meet with the priests.
Mm-hmm.
That is where we could
streamline
it all.
That's not ever planned, but I can put that as one of the resolutions of this.
Yeah. To me, that would be awesome.
Well, the thing is, if you have a pastoral solution, that's up to the priest.
Yeah,
so
right.
It is going to vary from parish to parish.
Yeah.
So you're not going to have a fixed, solid, and I'm glad, rule.
Yeah.
But
it's
no,
going to
but
be flexible.
Every situation
is
different.
You're going to have to have variation.
Yeah.
Good point. Yes.
I would agree, and I know how difficult it would be to do, but more education of the faithful would be, I think this is wonderful what you're doing this evening, and very helpful. And I think it'd be very helpful for both laity and the clergy if this was done in more education somehow. But I know the difficulties we have.
We'll try to get there. Yes.
I don't have too much of an issue with the differences in between different parishes and between different priests, different ministers, different reverends. In for us, it comes down to communication between us, the church, and the family. And then the family can get more of a tailored personal experience from that church. It doesn't have to be exactly the same as every other. You know, so there is a benefit to not having everything the same at every service.
Exactly. And if I may advise the people from the funeral homes, when people approach you, and maybe this is already happening, to schedule something, I think one of the first words that should be asked is, has this been coordinated with a priest or with that parish? You know, because it's difficult when everything is already finalized with at your end, and then we just need to ride on with that plan.
But it's all communication between all three parties.
That's right.
Yeah,
so, but somebody has to initiate it. And it's the family, right? Family. So.
Yeah, that it is. Communication is key in that because it goes both ways. There's nothing worse for us when somebody walks in and says, "So I went to see the priest at the funerals at whatever time."
Yeah.
And we're like, "Well, we already have a funeral, and we don't have staff, the cars, but you know, it goes both ways." So when we meet a family, you don't set it in stone until you get it more or less set, and you go, "Okay, we're going to call the church. We'll tee up the times." But it's the communication's there both ways.
Yeah.
Like we can't tell the church when they need to do a service, just like the church can't necessarily book us if we're
that's
already
right.
booked. It goes both ways.
Mm-hmm. I think something else that's very important too, if you're pre-planning all this and you speak to your parish priest as to what your requests are, then before you die, you get a different priest. It's very important that you follow up with the new priest so that he is aware of what your desires are.
Thank you for your comment, but I would like to just give a little clarification there. In my presentation, I don't mean to say, because this will be an added word for my brother priest, and they'll hate me. I don't mean to insinuate that you should plan this with your priest.
No.
Whatever material I provided, and I hope you peruse it one way or the other, it's for your own personal use that can be consulted during the time of death.
But
you made a good point that, okay, given the chance that the priest is open to plan this with you at the moment, but during the time of your death, it could be another priest.
Yes.
So really, I don't think it's ideal to even make that attempt to plan it with with your present pastor. Not that I'm avoiding work for this priest, but... yes, Teta.
I've helped couples to prepare for their funerals because they are aware that their adult children are no longer practicing the Catholic faith. And so they came to me and they said, what do we do? We would like to be buried in the Catholic tradition.
Yes.
And so I helped them choose readings, choose music, choose prayers, and they've got all that recorded.
Yeah, so that's something that I was kind of suggesting, but not to a hand tie with a priest that, okay,
no.
Father, Rector, this is my plan when I die.
No.
Make sure you execute
this.
And I have had people who came to me to say that, and I said, my dear sister, I cannot guarantee whether I will know, for instance, that you have died, and that, secondly, what is my control over that, unless I am authorized to do that, right? Like you mentioned about the will, and unless my name is mentioned somewhere, I will not have authority over you, no matter how close we are when we are leaving, when you are alive, right? So, but yes, we can help that way. This is part of helping.
No
right?
Priest names were mentioned.
That's right.
Okay.
Thank you. Any more observation, question, clarification? Well, thank you so much all for coming tonight. And I just want to acknowledge the people who worked behind the scene with me here before we conclude the night. I have here Jasmine, the secretary to the bishop. She's been very helpful. And I have there Armand. Armand is one of our accounting clerks. And of course, I have our vice chancellor, Martha, who also helped me with many things with this presentation. Thanks to all of you for coming tonight. Thanks, Caroline, for your presentation. It did help me personally. And for all of you, because, again, this is a night of fulfillment for me. I feel complete. I always felt incomplete because this is undone. Now I can check the list. Done. Okay, let's conclude with a prayer. And thank you for those who have participated with us through online. I know that Bishop Jensen is with us via GoTo because he has a prior commitment. He joined at the middle of his session. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now at the hour of our death.
Amen.
May the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. And may the Lord grant us a restful night and a peaceful sleep. Amen. Go in peace.
Thank you, Father.